issues that we're looking at here is, okay, if in some sense it's too late for us to do anything about the fact that information technology is important for mechanical systems, right? That's going to happen whatever we do. You know, nobody's going to take the microprocessors out of cars because we ask them to. But we're the people here who are educating students go and live in this world. And so what are we going to do about it? I mean, pretty clearly, the kinds of things that we've been doing up till now, though of course they're very good, don't necessarily address these issues. So how are we going to address these issues? That's one of the questions. How are we going to include information technology in education for engineers? And secondly, because we always do it both ways, what does information technology have to do for education? How can we use information technology in order to make education more efficient for engineers? All right, so our first speaker here, who is actually an expert on this field, David Wallace, who is an associate professor of mechanical engineering, will talk to us about media education. All right, here we go. What did Anthony say?
So what I'm going to talk about is really the new media possibilities that are enabled by the use of information technology in engineering education. To provide a little background about myself, I'm the associate director of the MIT CAD Lab. I do my research in the area of computer-aided design, and my teaching is in the area of product design, both at the graduate and undergraduate levels. So what am I going to do? I'm first going to provide a little bit of motivation, which is at least the angle at which I am going to be coming from in this presentation. Provide a few facts of things that we've learned and that are going on. Talk a little bit about some experiments that we've done in the department at MIT. And then move on to some thoughts about teaching and learning models in this new information technology-enabled environment. So to me, this represents the space in which we teach, and we're certainly used to in universities the notion of presence and traditional media, where traditional media may be classrooms, lectures, traditional labs, tutorials, and things like that. And of course, now into the fray, we have the possibilities of using new media and incorporating telepresence as part of our educational programs. And so really, ideally, we'd like to be able to work pretty seamlessly throughout this space. And some of the key questions are, how do we design our curricula in an informed way so that we can understand the difference in when we might want to use traditional media or new media, or presence and telepresence? And it's an important question because often the telepresence can compete or at least offer some of the similar sounding educational opportunities at a lower cost than a residential education. So moving on to motivation, what I think we need to be doing and are interested in doing is trying to develop and test new strategies for teaching when we have this combined media environment that can be applicable to a broad set of curricula. And we can understand when we might want to use presence or telepresence to really have the most effective educational opportunities possible. And what I mean by that is, first of all, we need high quality mass education, and we also need very high quality residential education, so we can clearly understand and show the value of the on-campus educational experience. So that's the motivation. And now I just want to move on some facts, or some I would like to pose as facts. And there's still often a lot of debate about presence or telepresence or correspondence in a slightly more dated form of the same thing. And this is in fact the No Significant Difference website. And what it has is a list of over 300 reviewed journal and conference articles that cite no significant difference based on location, i.e. presence or telepresence, alone. It's also available in book form. So in some sense, I think the debate about presence is really open. It's pretty clear you can do a good job with presence, and you can do a good job with telepresence. But presence, in a sense, has no inherent advantage. What really matters is what learning and motivational opportunities you provide in the educational experience. So it's kind of like, what do you do with the time? How well do you use this, the situation to provide an educational experience? We'll also just note that there is also a growing significant different site where most of the papers are finding that remote education has an advantage. And you know, one might speculate that this may be because some of those programs are fairly carefully thought out, maybe more than some of the traditional classes. So the message really is how things are implemented is very important no matter what you do. And it's not just the, whether you're doing it with information technology or with people together or remotely that's really going to be the most important factor. So you have to think carefully about how you, what your teaching strategy is. I think another observation is that we all generally feel that we could be doing a better job. And this is just an example from Ben Linder, who is a doctoral student in the department under Woody Flowers. But basically the idea is he surveyed senior students at six major universities, asking them how much energy was in a 9-volt transistor battery. And that's a log scale on the bottom, and you see a pretty widely varying response. And I mean, it's a fair debate. You could say, well, should we expect them to really be able to answer this question or not? And some people might say yes, some people might say no. But on the other hand, I think we can say we would like all of our graduating students to be able to look at the answer they're proposing and decide whether it's ridiculous or not. Right? And so we know, you know, and there's all kinds of other stories about, oh, you know, things happening. And in some ways, it's not, you know, the students in some sense aren't that much different than they were, maybe different experiences, but they're, you know, people just like everyone else was historically. And so we need to think about what we can do to improve the way we're teaching them. Some other facts. Sticking our lecture notes online is something that's fairly easy to do, and it certainly has administrative advantages, but in some ways it really has a modest educational impact. And this is probably the most common applications, but it really doesn't go to the core of trying to use the technology and new opportunities to teach better. So we really, it's not surprising because we need to design materials to take advantage of the media that we're using. And we need strategies and pedagogical reasons for choosing the different media. And, you know, simply stated, we design a lecture in a certain way if we're going to stand up and talk, just like I'm talking to you now. If we were going to be doing it in an electronic format with multimedia capabilities, we would design it and structure it very differently. So we shouldn't expect to be able to do just a direct port of materials from one media to the other and get big advantages. Another area of discussion or debate is often about what is the best way to teach. And if we look at a lot of different materials on education, and teaching engineering is one, and there's a number of books on the subject, in some ways there really is no singular best way to teach. So, of course, there are different types of people that like to learn using different types of formats of presentation of the material. They like to learn things in different order, theory first, examples first, motivation first, applications first. And there are different use patterns. Some people like to hear a story, follow it along. Other people really just want to go in, grab the salient facts. So those are all different possibilities that are really contingent upon the people themselves and different learning styles. There's also different types of learning, whether we're trying to do training or whether we're trying to really teach deep theory or general concepts. And there's different types of content. And we should expect that there may be different ways to address some of these issues differently. So it's not a question of what is the best approach, but how do we have a framework so that we can apply a lot of different tools and approaches in an effective manner. And this is one hypothesis that I certainly believe, and I'll show some experiments pertaining to in a bit, that at least the new media materials certainly can be designed so that they can accommodate some of the different learning style issues. Okay, and with that, we're now going to move on to talk a little bit about some experiments. And this is a new media teaching model that is a result of some experiments. I'll just give it to you up front. But the gist of it is to have students study codified material using lectures and quotes, in a sense, that are online. And then following that up with experiential activity or mentoring with someone that has experience or wisdom, if you will, that's hard to codify. And then providing the opportunity for in-practice application to really consolidate learning in a deep way. And that particular model was based on some experiments where we first tried to sit down and design a framework that we could provide the codified materials online, in a sense, in lieu of a lecture, and really motivating that structure around the different learning styles idea. And then once we wanted to do that, really evaluate it. How well does it compare to a regular classroom? And if we can use these materials in lieu of a class, how can we spend time differently with students versus a traditional lecture? So I'm just going to move on. So we developed a general template for providing lectures. And this was for actually an implementation of it, but for a traditional 90-minute lecture. And I just want to note, down the right side is what would be the equivalent of the lecture divided up into 94 different subtopics. And if you follow it through, it's more or less going to read like a story if you go point to point. It provides you very parallel access into just about every part of the lecture. Right now we're in a section on actually related to prototyping and actually how to prime things. And in that, the content is divided up, and it's hard for you to read, but essentially this is the, there's a bin which is for why do I want to know this. If there's any theory behind it, that's where the theory is provided. Procedural information, which is how you do the application, it's really an application. And examples, so the students can very quickly or conveniently, if you will, tab between different types of learning information. And then finally, within the subject, the students, so we're looking at how to, so that's the procedural part of priming, they can play a video, which is annotated, so they can watch and listen. They can listen to audio and look at the pictures, or they can go through a very traditional read and look at the pictures, just like an online textbook. And we've implemented four lectures in this way, two for product design and two related to classical control. Once we had, in particular, the prototyping lecture implemented, we wanted to compare this to our regular classroom teaching. So we had half of the class take the web lecture, and the other half have a traditional lecture on the same content. And they all had access to the same textbook, but you either had a class or you didn't. And then they had a project and an outside group evaluate the project. And what we could do is then track a lot of information, track how they did on the projects according to the jury, and also do focus groups to try to learn a little bit about what we're doing. So just to compare, first of all, the jury's scoring of the prototyping project. And what this is on the left is if we divide the class group and the web group, but we look at all of the assignments they did over the term where they were taught in the class and the same thing. And what we can show is that they are indeed expected to perform the same. And when we look at how they did on the assignment, in fact, there was about a 7.3% difference. So in other words, the people who only had the web-based experience did a little bit better than the people who had the class. And statistically, for these data, it's about a 1 in 100 chance of seeing that difference in the mean where they actually really were performing the same. So there's a reasonable statistical evidence that to say that they performed differently. Let's think a little bit about why. Here are some of the things we can design the online material to do. It's a classroom lecture, 90 minutes. Most lectures are either 1 hour or 90 minutes, or 90 minutes. Both are longer than people's attention spans. And if we look at how many if you will, wax at it. The students took online took to cover the entire lecture. The average was about 3, which corresponds to 33 minutes per session, which is very close, if you look at some of the data, to what people's attention spans are. This little snapshot down at the bottom is essentially the number of people studying as a function of time of day. And the only slot that's quiet is between 4 a.m. and 8 a.m. Spike is actually at lunchtime. And we also found through the focus groups that they liked being able to do the studying by themselves because they didn't feel peer pressure. They felt they could spend a lot of time where they didn't understand things and not feel like they were not as smart as the next person in the class, basically. And we also have data where we had these parallel delivery paths, and we can show that there were groups that were movie-centric, there were groups that were text and image-centric, and there were groups that switched back and forth, probably based on the content of the section and whether they thought a different media might have different types of information. So what we can say is that looking at these differences, one of the other nice features when we try experiments with new media materials is that we can actually track and understand a lot of things and learn about how to do better. But given the notion that this lecture like that online can work, the question then becomes, how do we use the class time? And so to follow up, what we did is, of course, next year, the entire class uses the web material. And we asked them to prepare beforehand by studying this, but the class is divided up into two groups and taught differently in person. One group, I call it the active classroom, so it's a lecture where we're following active learning type of guidelines. But the gist of it is we give a complete second coverage of the material, which is potentially a positive thing. For the other group, we actually make no attempt to cover all of the material, but we just go and work with them and do some things with them that cover part of the material. Then we follow the same prototypes where they all do the same sort of project and an external review of how they do. And in this case, again, we can show we would expect them to perform the same based on their other assignments. And we see a difference of about over 10%. And in this case, from a statistical standpoint, there's a chance of about 1 in 1,000 of seeing that big of a difference in mean when the two groups were actually the same. So it seems that that combination works pretty well. And again, we might think, well, why? And earlier on, I said a lot of education is about motivation and preparation and studying, which is important. On the left is in a survey how the students rated their preparation beforehand. And so in blue are the people that essentially thought they were coming to a lecture. And the red is the people who thought that they were going to do some things. And of course, you can see that the people in red were much more motivated to prepare ahead. These are the actual data, because they were all studying the web lecture. And what we can see is that the 60th percentile person coming to a classroom was less prepared than the least prepared person that was going to come and do an exercise. So there were some strong motivational differences. And in fact, the only differences in the instructions between the two groups is one said you're strongly encouraged to review the complete lecture before class. And the other one, we'll assume that you've covered it and we'll be working on things in our class period. So you can use the mix of information technology and traditional approaches to provide strong motivational forces. And when we asked students about, and this is in a survey, if I could have only had one of the forms of instruction, if we look at the people who had the class and the web, 60% said, I'd take the web only. If we look at the people that had the experience, essentially 80% said they would take the experience only. And that was in the fact that we didn't cover all of the information there. So if they took the experience only, they would have missed a huge part of what they really needed to learn. But they placed a very high value on that experience. And so in some sense, one of the messages is when we're working with the students, we should be trying to do things with them and things that are not readily codified in other forms. So where might this type of model apply? And so this model, which we were trying to support, was studying codified materials using appropriate IT-based approaches, experiential activities, and then in practice application. And what I want to add is each lecture took about 500 hours and $100, 500 hours to produce for about an hour of lecture. So there's some overhead in preparing them. But certainly, this seems like an appropriate form where this knowledge base is stable. There's a lot of students or a lot of customers, if you want to think of it that way. And they may or may not be super interested in learning the material because we can bring in very high production value. We also actually have used this model at the Ford Design Institute for their technical employee training. And what it's probably not appropriate for is emerging knowledge where there's a small customer base and very strong interest and motivation to learn on their own. And you don't need essentially some of the production value. So now with that through, what I just want to talk and close up with are some thoughts about teaching in this new media environment. And this is based on work done by a committee with several different disciplines involved in the Department of Mechanical Engineering. How am I time-wise?
You have 4 minutes.
Okay, should be just about right. So, when we worked on this, and what we really wanted to do is try to find a way to think about all the possibilities and how we might apply them in some different teaching strategies. And these are some methods that have really been around a long time. One which we call the Socratic method, which is independent study guided by mentoring, which is more or less what I've described. Just in time, which is the notion that you're working on an application and you learn when you need to because you've encountered a problem. And finally, a classical scientific discovery mode of learning through observation, study, and hypothesis and experiments. And so really, what we think needs to be done is to identify the combinations of material delivery, hard facilities, and interactions for these different types of learning models, and trying to understand what ones suit different types of materials and teaching goals. What we envision for pretty well all of these is one thing is that most students will have laptops. And for the Socratic, we think that we'll have these types of codified lecture modules that support different learning styles. And then we can combine them with mentoring experiences. And these mentoring experiences may be mini lectures. They may be some form of a classical lecture. They could be personal mentoring. They could be electronic forums. They could be online quizzes with feedback. It could be a studio environment. And there's activities in all of those areas. And we'd like to think about how we would use them. And one thing I can say that I feel pretty confident about, maybe a bit controversial, but at least for me, I find that 15 minutes of direct contact with two or three students is easily worth a couple hours of me standing and lecturing. So that's kind of what's driving that model. For the just-in-time model of education, what we think is needed is essentially a marketplace of learning modules so that students or employees are working on projects, and when they encounter problems, they can find the resources to learn the bits that they need at the time. And the reason we think there's going to be some sort of a module marketplace is that the projects are often very different and diverse. And so it's hard to predict up front what types of codified material you would have. And it would be, I think, too great a task for any one institute to produce all of the materials that are needed in an appropriate way. And you essentially need highly customizable curricula. And this is one of the challenges in 2009, which is a product design course that we teach, where different teams of students are all working on different projects, and so they run into different problems as they're working throughout the term. And finally, the scientific discovery model we envision. This is a picture of the high school chemistry lab concept, where but really the classroom and the laboratory are integrated. And there's a lot of interesting issues related to the use of physical space versus virtual labs, haptic devices, for example, to virtual simulations, or physical toolboxes that need to support this type of environment. So there's a lot of potential combinations of traditional and information technology approaches that need to be thought about. So in summary, I think there's quite a bit to be optimistic about, as there's a lot of new teaching opportunities that are arising. And I think what we need to be doing is thinking about how we can use them effectively. The one thing I will say, though, is that things are moving very fast. There are a number of open universities, virtual universities, companies or organizations offering courses at very low cost. And so I think now is really the time that we need to explore and develop a strategy for teaching in this environment. So that's the end of my talk.
So questions for David? Maybe, Tony, maybe we could get you to try to work on your technical project while David's answering questions.
You can say that the direct contact is maybe 8 times better than a lecture. How did you arrive at that metric?
Well, that particular metric, that's one that's not as derived as most of the data that I put up there, whereas careful, and that's, to be honest, my gut feeling. And I guess provide some substance to that in the graduate course that I'm teaching, I now lecture. A number of the lectures are using this approach, and then we work on activities. I do some traditional lectures, but just about every third week, I don't lecture, and I have 10 minutes or 15-minute meetings with 2 students at a time, see what they're doing, and I work with them. And I feel that the results are better. So that's a much more qualitative statement, but that's kind of what I base that on. And I find that 15 minutes, to be practical, you could spend more time and it would be great, but that's the chunk of time that it becomes a manageable proposition for me as an individual doing this. So, yep. Anything else?
To follow up to that, with what you described with the new technology and integrating it into teaching and then thinking about distance learning as an area that is growing, then back to your 8-to-1
right.
Contact, where do you see things perhaps going? Is the distance learning going to replace residential education or what?
Sure. I guess I'll offer some thoughts on that. It's, of course, speculation, just like anyone else, I guess, answering the question. My own opinion is that, first of all, I think the line between distance learning and residential learning will become more blurred, and that I think even in a residential university, some things will be done almost in a distance learning style, such as the very codified materials. Examples of that, I could look the references up, but I know of lots of cases where they've begun to offer courses on campus, both internet-based and traditional, and the internet-based kind of clearly went out in terms of what the students want to do. So the lines will become blurred, but I think that what the residential universities really need to do is focus on the unique part that you can't really do at a distance, so that there's still a very strong motivation for wanting to have a residential education, because you can work essentially with your peers and also with people that have wisdom to impart that can't be readily codified and is easily disseminated. Now, in the distance learning mode, you can still try to do things to help impart that. So, for example, you might set up a scenario where maybe you're broadcasting a type of learning experience where you have some students who are kind of up and actually working and interacting almost in a mentoring way with the faculty, and then there's observers at remote sites. And that can help bring some of the flavor of the one-on-one experience. But it's still, from a motivational standpoint, very different than the knowledge of the student that they're going to have to go and talk and do these things and be seen by others. So I don't think there'll be a complete replacement, but there may be a shift in scale and what's done in different ways. So, yeah.
One more question, and then we'll move on to the next topic.
It seems easy to embrace these kinds of technologies when you try to present theory or topical knowledge, like the knowledge part.
Yes.
What about the know-how, like how to solve problems? Have you thought a little bit
yes,
about
I mean,
that?
Yes, I mean, that's... I think, again, I actually, the point you make, I think, is a good one. And it goes back to, I think that things that can be readily codified are very appropriate for this type of approach. Things that can't be is where the value added in the experience is. And that, you know, in a sense, a know-how that's procedural, which is, in fact, lots of times what you see in employee training programs at companies, that's just as codifiable as anything else. The kind of wisdom of actually doing an experience with experiment, say, with someone who has a lot of depth in that field is something that you're going to have a much more difficult time packaging, if you will, in this way. And that's where I think that, you know, a big part of the residential education's value should be.
Okay, I know some of you have more questions, but we should really get on because we're behind schedule, and we may have technical difficulties. David's going to be on the education panel coming right up, so please grill him some more.
So SMA is the Singapore MIT Alliance, and this is a little video that we made for promotional purposes, but it also gives you a sense of the program. This was launched last year. The first class will be graduating this summer, and there are two programs initially, in advanced materials and in high performance computation. And the as you can see, there's a very significant distance component that I'll be describing a little more in a moment. The program begins by the students in Singapore with about a month of various teaching activities. They then come to here at MIT. This here is indicating what they do while in Singapore, which you recognize as MIT. The beginning of the program, the 2 days, is focused on sort of the spirit of technopreneurship within MIT, with examples from the MIT faculty, here's John Vanderson, as well as a continuation of the more formal activities that they began in Singapore related to coursework and project work. There's also the usual social activities that have been arranged for the students here. There, we're teaching them how to abandon healthy Southeast Asia. we were putting on one of the boats that went to the bottom of a lake in Arkansas.
Could you turn your mic on, please?
And here the students are saying how much in particular they enjoyed my lectures during their time at MIT.
the when they return from MIT back to Singapore, they continue on with about a month of classes at Singapore, and then begins the distance aspect of it. And a key component of the distance aspect is that you saw MIT students in the classroom there, and now in a moment you will be seeing the Singaporean students sitting in Singapore. We send two streams to Singapore. One is the video stream, which is all the usual talking head business. The other stream is the data stream, all right, which is essentially uncompressed PowerPoint slides and other data aspects that therefore arrive uncorrupted on the Singapore side. The facilities that you're seeing here are the ones at MIT. There is a mirror site at Singapore. And in fact, in some of the courses, we even beamed internally to MIT. You're seeing that now from the Singaporean, the SMA students' perspective, where you saw the two large screens at the front of the room. The left is the video stream, the right is the data stream. And in fact, these are the kinds of PowerPoint animations that are used in some of the lectures, and I'll be talking about that a bit subsequently as well. This again is from the Singaporean side, Jacob White on the left. You see him now in the inset here, and on the right was the data stream that he sends over, which you see here as well. And again, that's from the SMA student perspective. What was being used on the left is a document camera, which is simply a higher data integrity version of a Blackboard. There's a significant asynchronous component in which all of the various lecture materials, digitized videos, lecture notes, slides, are posted on websites and integrated using effectively a system related to the command system used at MIT. Here you see the Singaporean students viewing Professor Bert Siemis, the sequel, all right? Having seen him once live, they now see him through the digitized videos, which we found to be a very effective way for them to be able to review material. There's also other various, by this point, standard mechanisms for them to search through the material and to pick the various pieces that they're looking for. In addition to the distance interactions, many of the students spend time at MIT, in particular all the PhD students. And here you see them commingled with MIT students on campus and also talking about research projects here with Professor Suresh. Research is a significant component of the SMA program, and I'll talk about that a bit more later. Here, it's appropriate to indicate that the third program is housed primarily, but not exclusively, in mechanical engineering. You see Professor Chun and Professor Hart and their counterparts in Singapore designing the manufacturing program, which is the third of the three academic programs. There are also major players from the Sloan School in that program, as there are, in fact, in several of the programs that are currently launched. And so I think that is about it. This they're just saying how great everything is, and that and I think at this point I can conclude. Seems to have concluded for me. And so what I'd like to do now is make a few, there were a few uplifting moments at the end that I spared you, but what I'd like to do now is use that as data and make a few observations, most of which I think are quite obvious. First, it's an experiment in teaching and research, and I think you saw that I put at a distance, but that's only really part of what all of this is about. And so I'd like to first make some general remarks. The key one is that SMA is not really typical of distance efforts. The first is there's a focus on an elite graduate cohort. The students that are admitted essentially pass the same kind of muster that we require of all our own students here at MIT in terms of GREs and, of course, letters of recommendation. So again, the focus is on elite as opposed to many other distance efforts, which are more for the unwashed masses. Both teaching and research components figure prominently. Again, many distance efforts are focused on information transfer, much more the formal teaching as opposed to the more labor-intensive research side. There are both distance and face-to-face elements, as I indicated. The students come here and the faculty go there. All right, so there's a significant component of what we consider more classical modalities that are not facilitated by technology in any significant way. There's a very high faculty to student ratio. Many distance education efforts are stimulated by the desire to be able to much more inexpensively educate a much larger group of students. In this case, we seem to have almost maximized the inverse of that ratio in terms of the resources that are being devoted to these students. There's a strong emphasis on interaction. All right, this is not a case where there's a lot of tools that are developed, put online, and they become a one-on-one activity between the student and the tool. There's a lot of interaction between the faculty and the students. There are strong links with MIT residential initiatives. Many of the programs have, for example, stimulated MEng degrees here on campus based on material developed within the Singapore MIT Alliance rubric. There's also a very strong partnership emphasis with Singapore. There are Singaporean faculty involved, so that students, even when they're in a distance mode relative to MIT faculty, have Singaporean faculty from NUS and NTU that serve as local face-to-face faculty in the usual sense. So there's always this component of a more traditional environment. There are very advanced facilities and technical support. This is not the kind of thing one can do in one's own garage yet. And finally, there is a quasi-antipodal geographic framework that was apparently maximized for frequent flyer miles rather than convenience by our dear provost, Bob Brown, when he set up this program. And finally, there's, because of all that, a rather non-trivial price tag. Again, distance education sometimes is seen as the economic panacea for educating a larger and larger group of people. Certainly, they should not emulate the Singapore MIT Alliance if that is their objective. So let me then make a few more specific observations, first related to teaching, and then just a few on research. The first on teaching is that technology is no replacement for and can significantly detract from scholarly, organized, complete, and effective development, by which I mean preparation and assimilation of educational material. And to give you one example of that, this is very anecdotal, obviously. We had one course in which there was a great emphasis on more dynamic presentations, and there was not too much background material available. We had another course which had much more detailed lecture notes, but much more static and less stimulating, in some sense, lectures. And we found that the students, though they certainly enjoyed the dynamic presentations, would much prefer that we spent our time on making sure there was always adequate codified material for them to be able to appropriate and subsequently apply the material. This is a bit peculiar, perhaps, to the SMA program in the sense that we're developing new graduate curricula, so existing textbooks are not readily available, and inasmuch background material is more imperative developed for each course. But nevertheless, I think there's a more general message to be taken away. I'd like to, I guess that's not the right button. I'd like to go back to the asterisk, which says it can significantly detract from, but need not. We saw a number of examples that Dave Wallace showed where obviously content technology was enhancing it. I've chosen to take this more negative view because I think there's a lot more material out there that's not exciting, and the kinds of things that Dave is doing is exception, not the rule. This really refers to, as I just described, content technology, and somehow, some sense, using technology to enhance the way the content is presented. Right? There's another aspect of technology which is obviously crucial to the SMA effort, which is transmission technology. You saw there some of the live beaming sessions that are done. We have the classroom here at MIT, and there's the MIT faculty member, there's the MIT students present. That is live simulcast over internet too, all right, to the Singapore site. All right. Obviously, having all those pieces work is absolutely critical to the success of the program. And I think the summary at this point is that advanced video conferencing technology is reasonably effective and reasonably reliable, or reasonably reliable and reasonably effective. Issues remain. Audio and video clarity. You saw the audio and video clarity. We've actually had at least as much trouble with the audio as the video, which is a bit surprising. Bandwidth and compression are an issue. We have MIT faculty that are extremely animated. In Singapore, that comes out as kind of a throwback to claymation, all right, after they've been sent through this low-pass filter. Apart from sedating our faculty, there doesn't appear to be a near-term solution to the problem, and it's something that has to be addressed. Queuing and flow is also critical. We all take advantage or take for granted in an environment like this how easily it is to pick up on peripheral cues in order to know where the attention has to be focused. At a distance, a lot of that cueing goes away, partially because of clarity, partially because of camera angles, partially because of one's ability to see the remote site on a screen, which tends to be rather small and at the back of the classroom. So for all those reasons, things are not quite where they should be, but they're not bad. And the feedback is generally good based on over 100 live beam sessions and also on student performance.
Can I give you this one?
Yes. Is this not working?
Battery's dead, I think.
Battery's dead.
That's for the room, and this one's for me, for the recording.
Oh, no, so I keep the other one also?
Yeah, might as well.
I'm going to get electrocuted by the end. In terms of student performance, we did comparisons, not quite as scientific as Dave's, in terms of the MIT cohort and the SMA cohort, and we found that they were statistically indistinguishable. So much so that the data looked rigged. But I think that the takeaway is not so much the data as it is the fact that the Singaporean students, or the students in Singapore, were able to learn the material at a rate similar and an ability similar to that of the MIT students here on campus. Observation three is that lectures without student participation are a real waste of expensive SMA resources. And as opposed to alternatives, such as lectures with much interaction or recitations and tutorials. And the reason is, if we pay facility charges, we have a very expensive room. Technician charges, we have two or three technicians, typically on each side, making sure that the event transpires smoothly. Internet 2 and ISDN access charges, all these live simulcasts are done over I2 or ISDN. Off-hour extra compensation, because of the fact that Singapore is 13 hours different from us. The lectures take off typically between 7 and 9 in the morning and 8 and 10 in the evening. If you add all that up, and this is all being done for real-time sessions, and all you have is a faculty member that spends 99% of the time talking, that's not really a very good use of those resources. And in some sense, this is only made more clear what's already clear at MIT, and that's why I put the SMA in parentheses. At MIT, there are lots of charges and costs associated with giving a lecture as well. They're not as easily attributed to things like technicians and all the rest, but they're clearly there. And once again, you might ask, is that really a very good use of resources? And that's precisely, I think, one of the points that Dave Wallace was making in his earlier talk. Of course, what enables all this is web archiving and integration so that you can get the material before class and then use the class for more interesting interactive maneuvers. And in fact, that has been used very successfully so far at SMA. We archive the digitized lecture videos, the slides, and the lecture notes. And this provides for a very rich environment. And when I go to Singapore, I often will circulate through the cubicles where the students sit. And in fact, you see them very often going back to these videos of the lectures to see what were the key points. And they also have access to the lecture notes, which develop things in more detail. And they seem to that way, in some sense, it acts for a replacement for the more constant and redundant interactions that would occur if they were not at a distance. On research, I have just two very obvious observations. The first one is that most MIT faculty already engage in some form of distance research, all right, back to MIT while on travel or to institutions of students of colleagues. The data for that is that it's certainly difficult to find an MIT faculty member at MIT. They must be somewhere, and wherever they are, they must be interacting with their students back at home in order to continue making progress on the research front. On a slightly less obvious observation is that distance research can be enhanced by really now standard technology. One-to-one video conferencing, which is just a euphemism for net meeting and variants thereof, slightly more sophisticated shared collaborative applications. It's now very easy to take scribbled notes as you would present to a student sitting across from you, put it through a scanner, have that integrated into a shared and collaborative whiteboard so that you can annotate it and the student at the other side, in this case in Singapore, can annotate it simultaneously. And again, that kind of a session is almost as good as what you might be able to construct with a student sitting on the other side of the desk. And finally, there are various hardware devices, tablets, and other input systems that make this shared collaborative application usage a little easier. And in fact, we've integrated all this together into little individual distance kits that we give to the faculty participating in the SMA program so that they have all the access to both the software and the hardware that they need in terms of interacting with their students. And finally, then, by way of conclusions, even at 12,000 miles, teaching and research remain Well, they remain teaching and research. And that's more or less by construction, where a lot of this program is in some sense not revolutionary. It's reactionary, trying to replicate some of the very good things about MIT at a distance. Obviously, some of the things are a little more revolutionary, but we're trying to keep a balance between the two. Good transmission technology is absolutely essential, and I would say it's not quite there, but it's almost there. As you could tell from my earlier comments, I'm a little not quite as enthusiastic about content technology unless it's very carefully applied. Finally, some regular face-to-face interactions are still crucial, in particular for research. I think in terms of establishing a rapport with a research student, which most of us have now done in terms of launching the research aspect of SMA, that would be clearly impossible if there were only net interactions that were available. And that's all I have prepared, and I'd be glad to take any questions that you might have.
Questions?
Forbes. Tony, I've had the experience in a couple of instances of setting up a research program with Imperial College in London, where we started and completed the project basically by email. And in the beginning, the people that were involved only knew each other vicariously, in the sense that they only knew the two project directors who in turn knew each other. And it was very interesting to me that over the period of the 3 or 4 months when those intense projects occurred, there was a real camaraderie and sharing that went on between the people that were working on the project, even though they never saw each other in person, even with video conferencing. Now, I'm just wondering if there was any of this kind of personal infrastructure building that occurred here between the students.
Probably to a certain extent. I think that the students come in and they're immediately blasted with sort of a standard MIT kind of graduate program. And so there's not much time left actually for sort of the more cohort building activities. We've actually lightened up some of the programs precisely because we felt given the distance, that there was not enough time left on the side for those kinds of relationship. So I think the answer is that it's probably a little different in terms of research group to research group and faculty to students in terms of priorities as to what they have on their plate and what they have to get done first. But I certainly agree with you that in the cases where it did happen, it was clear that there was a way to develop some kind of a rapport electronically. Yes?
Do you see an inherent benefit in remote coordination of research due to the fact that there has to be some attention given to documenting results in order to facilitate the communication? Is that something you've seen as a benefit?
It's something I've certainly seen before in terms of when faculty travel, sometimes they have a better sense of exactly what's going on than when they're here. And to a certain extent, that's also happened in the SMA program, in the sense that there's a more conscious effort, all right, to make sure that both sides know what's going on, and therefore communications tend to be a little better. The one thing, your comment reminds me of, is that there's also this usual wisdom about progress being better, because if you're separated by 12 hours, of course, there's one side that's working, right, they pass the ball to the other side. The fallacy in that argument, of course, is that graduate students already are precessed by 12 hours, all right? And so, in fact, everybody's up at the same time. So that has not panned out quite the way we anticipated.
What I saw in the video about 15, 20 students, it would be much cheaper for the Singapore government to send them here and just stay a couple of years if they're studying a master's degree. What's the benefit of going through all of these expenses?
Yeah, a few million. There's several answers to that. There are several aspects to the answer to that. The first is that the same way as MIT sees as an investment and an experiment in terms of understanding how these kinds of technologies can be applied, right? So does Singapore, right? And obviously Singapore would like to position itself and is in fact positioning itself as a hub for education in Southeast Asia, right? And in as much knowing how these technologies can be applied is obviously going to be crucial. So there's a clear sense from both the MIT and from the Singapore side that understanding how to use these technologies is very important. The other thing, of course, it's not only 25 students. What you saw were various snapshots, right? The steady state population of students will be more like 50 times 5, or 250 students. And as you know, an MIT education, in fact, is not so cheap either. So if you do the multiplication, all right, it's not such a comparison. But the key point is that this is really seen as a way of exploring what can be done, right, within the sort of context and confines of what we consider to be quality, top-level education, using some of these new modalities in a creative way. So that, yes, sorry, Seth.
Even if it is the ballpark, could you give some idea of the cost for one course?
Or for one course? Right. Well, no. I won't. But the reason I won't is that in fact I mentioned at the beginning there's both research and teaching components. So in fact, by dividing the total number by the number of courses, right, I'm applying a research overhead on each of those courses, which is not very significant.
What was the cost of the system?
By the end of 5 years, including costs both on the MIT side and the Singapore side. It will be well over $100 million.
The group in Singapore, is it affiliated to any school there?
Yes, of course. I'm sorry.
Which school is that?
What you would have seen or what you would have heard on the audio is that there are two, actually there's more than two now, there are two primary universities in Singapore, National University of Singapore and Nanyang Technological University. Both are involved. No, the program was just launched last year. So as of now, the answer is simple, exactly zero. Hopefully. Over the next 5 years? Yeah, as I said, there'll be roughly 35 times 5, about 150 students graduating each year from the professional master's degree. And in addition, over the course of the program, I guess there will be about maybe 50 or 60 MEng and PhD research candidates that are also graduating.
All right, let's thank our speaker again. The next item on our agenda is a panel discussion of education. The panel participants are Eden Herleman, who is the professor and department chair at Purdue University, P.K. Raju from Auburn, Professor Nansu from MIT, and Dave Wallace also from MIT. And so the format is each panelist will say a few words, depending on what they feel like saying, then we'll have discussion of that, and then we'll have a group discussion of everything all together. Okay? So. We can bring these panelists up here so that they can sit at this table and look exalted.
Thank you. Okay, since we have distinguished colleagues who will be speaking on their programs, I'll be very brief. Some of the things that you heard in terms of how we are trying to conduct education and whatnot has to be considered in the context of a lot of other things we are doing in the Department of Mechanical Engineering. So let me just say a few words, and then I'll ask our colleagues here to speak on what they have in mind. At MIT, in our department, we create a complete new undergraduate curriculum, and we teach in a very different fashion. We graduated our first class last year under this new curriculum. So this curriculum is, simply put, an integrated way of teaching to provide better context for learning. So for example, in the area of fluids, thermodynamics, and heat transfer, we have one sequence. So we do not have a separate subject for heat, for thermodynamics as such, but we teach all three combined so that we can provide better context for learning. We have four of these sequences, and we are writing new books, and new books will be published by Oxford University Press under the special series known as MIT Pappalardo Series of Mechanical Engineering Books. So thanks to Neil Pappalardo and Jane Pappalardo's support, we are able to create an endowment fund for book writing, and hopefully from now into perpetuity, we'll have lots of books coming out, and the first series of undergraduate core textbooks will be coming out sometime, I hope, next year or so. So we have invested greater money supporting faculty effort to write new textbooks, developing new teaching materials, and new ways of teaching, and so forth. In addition, we will be spending, we just got support from this MIT-Microsoft alliance, I guess, whereby we will be developing new ways of teaching. Dave Wallace talked about three different modes of learning, and in order to do that, we'll be actually developing all the details as to how those things can be implemented. So one of the things we are doing is we are restructuring or we are modifying our lecture halls so we can indeed teach these two different modes of learning, namely scientific discovery and Socrates' way mode of learning will be tried in a new lecture hall. So we're building new lecture hall, and so that's ongoing as well. So we'll be tearing apart our existing lecture hall starting this January, and so and then on top of that, to implement this hands-on kind of teaching, we have renovated all of our teaching labs, and some of you may see it tomorrow. And so it has taken greater investment in terms of both the time of the faculty and financial resources to make it happen. And so we are continuing to put greater of investment in these areas. And some of my colleagues say that, gee, we're investing too much money in undergraduate education. But when you actually look at what we have done, most of our investment in education has gone into graduate education. And I won't belabor the point, I won't give you the details. But most of our faculty members teach 3 hours a week, and the rest of the time do research and supervising graduate students. So in proportion to the investment made in terms of faculty salary, what have you, clearly graduate education has been getting most of our attention. In recent years, we tried to make sure that our undergraduates get the best education any institution, anywhere can provide. And that's the thing we have been doing. And we have been helped a great deal by our alumni with a vision as to what it is that MIT ought to do to make MIT the place where students should come and learn. So we have these many concurrent activities taking place. And I think in that context, you have to understand some of these things taking place. So as part of now the MIT Cambridge program, there will be something very similar to MIT Singapore program, which will be launched sometime very soon. The money will come out of a British government and the UK government, and we'll be again launching somewhat similar, but perhaps very different in content and so forth, with the University of Cambridge in England. Again, with the hope of changing Cambridge to be more like MIT, you know, that's sort of what we are told. And this department will be the first department to be engaged in that experiment. So we will be accepting 6 students from Singapore, and we'll be sending 6 of our students to Cambridge. And one of the things we have to work out is to make sure that when our students go over to Cambridge, indeed they can get all the credit hours that they need to satisfy so they can graduate in the same time period. So many of these things are going on. And indeed, there are lots of exciting things happening here at MIT, and I just don't have enough time to go into all of this. But perhaps during the next, during this evening and tomorrow, if you have any questions, we'll be very happy to answer anything you have in mind. Okay? With that, I'd like to introduce our colleagues, Dan Herman from Purdue, and he'll be talking to us about what's going on at Purdue. Okay. Dan?
Thank you. Could you go ahead and try to turn on the projector, please? Well, it's my pleasure to be here with you today. I've really enjoyed the workshop, and I thought what I'd do is just briefly and just take a couple minutes. I think we're all going to just take 5 or so minutes and then open it up to the group. But I just touched on a few points of things going on at Purdue, some of which might be unique, some of which you might see going elsewhere. And the four topics in IT and education that I highlighted are virtual labs, distance design teams, innovation realization lab, and then web-based courseware. And those are some topics that I believe other folks are working on as well. The when I start with web-based courseware, we have done some experiments with courses called web-enhanced or web-based. And our most recent example is a graduate course, a combustion course. And there's the components that come to mind in that. We have the lectures on streaming video, so there are basically the students can anytime through the semester tap into the lectures, very similar to the last presentation. We have then, in addition to that, PowerPoint notes in parallel. I think the strategy that's been used in that is the notes are not complete. The notes have some blanks to sort of encourage this active haptic participation, I guess you'd say, in note-taking and try to engage the students a bit more.
Could you please advance the, I'm sorry, you'll have to, of course. So those are the five, or the six areas. And here's the topics I was just talking about. We have the on-demand viewing of lectures, and sort of an uncertified stat is this is Professor Gore in combustion this semester, the latest one, 10 hits per student per lecture. We think that's the students in the class trying to relook at the lectures. Downloadable notes with blanks. One of the interesting things, which you know, a number of you may have as well, is sort of the frequently asked questions bulletin board. Whereas students begin to ask questions and they begin to be, consistencies begin to develop, then the faculty member works diligently to create a very nice answer to that and posts it. There's a chat room involved, and then has divided the class up into distance study groups and assigned students to be leaders in those study groups. I think those are about 5 students or so. The grade sheets online, and then that's the web address for that particular course. So. Next slide. The next thing I'll talk about is just briefly distance design teams. We heard some of that. This involves interdisciplinary, multi-university design teams, and there's a number of experiments going on. I know Alan Bennington's here from Leeds. There's some experiments with Purdue and A&M. The one that Alan's involved with is Arizona State, Leeds, Boeing, and Rolls-Royce, if I recall. So this is an undergraduate design team working across those boundaries. Industry advisors as well, and then internet and whiteboard capabilities enable that. If I get the next slide as well. There's a project that's called the Innovation Realization Lab. It impacts on something we heard at lunch. This is an NSF project between Cranard, which is the management and business school at Purdue, and the engineering schools. This is where we pair an MBA student with a PhD student in the last 2 years of his or her PhD. And the goal is then to get the, I'm sorry, there's a typo there. That's
PhD. The goal is to commercialize the PhD, the technology coming out of the thesis, so the two students work together, and there's some network distance collaboration involved with that. So that gets to this last, some of the comments at lunch. And the very last thing I'll briefly talk about is some virtual lab experiments. Some of our faculty use animation in classes. I'm sure that's common with you. And then one thing that reaches down to the high school level is something called remote scope. And if I could have the next slide just briefly. This is where we've, at Purdue, are trying to work with the high school in terms of education, inquiry-based science. And so there's a set of microscopes manned by experts at the university. And then in principle, the high school students are able to remotely access a set of slides. The next, there's multiple samples you can see, multiple magnifications, and the students can control those few parameters. The very last slide gives you some overview of that. And in principle, it's a network of multiple types of microscope scanning probes, optical, near-focal scanning, in principle, SEMs as well, and then a set of high schools. Thank you.
Well, thank you, Dan. I think we'll hear from all speakers first and then take questions. And the next speaker will be Professor Ajil from Auburn University.
Yeah, I'll go there.
Okay.
Technology marketplace interface into undergraduate engineering classrooms. So I want to share with you the methodology we are trying at Auburn, and we have developed some course modules which can be used at the senior level, at the sophomore level, and we are now trying to go to the freshman level. And so the idea here is to bring real-world issues into engineering classrooms, and it's collected at Liddy. We have a group of faculty from engineering and business, and we have a team of evaluators from the College of Education, and a group of students from business and engineering working on these projects. The outline of my presentation, I'll make it very brief. Just want to share with you the goals and instructional objectives and some of the case studies we developed and the dissemination results. And solving real-world engineering problems. The educational objectives are to connect SMED courses to real-world problems, provide excitement of discovery, and motivate active learning. And the second goal is to improve higher-level cognitive skills of the students. The students should be able to identify criteria, analyze alternatives given multiple criteria, make a choice, and defend the choice persuasively, be actually involved in learning situations. And the third goal is to integrate information technologies into the course material, that is, enhance synchronous learning opportunities and enhance asynchronous learning opportunities. The asynchronous learning opportunities are provided through a CD-ROM or even a web-based material where the students can learn from that material, discuss with their peers. And the synchronous learning opportunities are provided for them when they come to the classroom and do the role-playing
that has been taking the roles of the people involved in the industry in the real problem. So I'll share with you some of the examples, the models we developed, the methodology to achieve these goals and objectives, shaping the future of engineering education. We have heard many people talk here. National organizations say the same thing. Industry executives say the same thing. They want to integrate theory, design, and practice. So what we did here was to develop a case study. And this case study is we develop it in partnership with an industry, identify a real problem there, and bring the real problem into the classroom. That is, we interview right from the CEO to the technician who was involved in the problem, and take record the conversation, document it, take pictures, videos, and put a multimedia CD on together. And the students will have access to both the written version of the case study and as well as the CD on. So we have web-based material available, the video available, the CD-ROM available, and written case study. The second objective for us was to show the relevance of SME education to real-world problems. MIT may not have this problem, but some of our institutions have this problem. That is, we have a high dropout rate of students when from freshman to sophomore year. Not because they can't understand the courses, not because they have a low ACT or SAT scores, but what we found out was they drop out from engineering because they don't see the relevance of the science and math taught in freshman level to the engineering courses of what engineers do later in life. So most of them transfer to business courses. So what we thought was to show them the relevance of science math principles to the real world problem. And that we think we can do it by a case study using both a multimedia as well as web-based case studies in the classroom. Some examples of the case studies. This is a Dell steam plant case study. I think I should briefly describe this to you. What happened here is, after regular maintenance of a turbine generator set, they started the turbine generator, and the system started vibrating, and the vibrations were so heavy that the building started shaking, and people ran helter-skelter. So we documented it and brought the problem to the classroom, interviewing right from the plant manager to the technician to show how decision making is done in the real world and what vibrations are and why a course in vibrations is necessary and how the vibration principles are related to physics, math, etc. So mechanical engineering, vibration, safety, and instrumentation was the topics we looked at. And we developed another case study with NASA, design of the solid rocket booster field joint to consider ethical, safety, reliability, risk, schedule, and cost factors, ethical considerations in engineering design, statistical methods. And this is joint effort with NASA Marshall. And then learning from failure. We have another case study that is the Challenger episode to teach the students what happens if you make a wrong decision and how wrong decisions can be made in engineering designs. And we worked with Auknet USA. It's a Japanese company. They do real-time online auto auctions to show students the difference between satellite and web-based systems. And this is an interesting case study.
we worked with Chick-fil-A. And I was surprised to know that the operating system you select for the point of sales terminal, where you have the employee selling you the sandwich, makes a difference in time, in the delivery time of your sandwich. Say, for example, if they select Windows CE or CE system, operating system, versus NT system, you can get the sandwich 5 minutes earlier. And 5 minutes makes a difference. And I thought this is an excellent case to show to the students why they need to know about these operating systems. And we had the support from the CEO of Chick-fil-A, and we brought this into the classroom. Another case study we did was with a nuclear power plant, and to show thermodynamics, heat transfer, and nuclear power. And this is the design of a cooling tower. And again, this is also an interesting case study. This is planning a maintenance outage. We were given access into the power plant when they were doing a maintenance outage. It's a $2 million project. We were there with our cameras and tape recorders, taped the whole thing, and developed the case study. The idea here is to show how a huge project is handled in the real world and what the surprises will be. For example, here they replaced a rotor, okay, in the maintenance. And in the end, they got a new rotor, and they were fitting it in. The rotor length was shorter than the required one. And that was a challenge for the plant manager. And that's one of the aspects we brought into the classroom, apart from the other technical details. Now, I used a set of these modules as a course in my sophomore level class, teaching concepts in engineering design. We had two groups, one using this case studies, one using the lecture mode of teaching the subject. And I'm not going into the details of the evaluation. But what we found was a majority of students found this case study methodology to be interesting, exciting, and relevant and useful. And the students realized the connection of theory and real-world practice, perceived that the method assisted them in enhancing the learning process, and multimedia materials help improve learning-driven factors. We have also developed a model to study the differences between a multimedia lecture and a written lecture, or written notes, how the students perceive it. And we have a publication out of it. And again, the learning-driven factors, like learning interest, challenging, self-reported learning, and learn from others, are the important aspects of using this multimedia. We have tried this in different courses. Already about 710 students went through this. We tried it in business, about 880 students. We tried it in Alabama A&M and other minority institutions, and they found it very useful. Now I want to make a sales pitch here. We are, as a part of our dissemination effort, we are organizing a workshop from May 11th to 13th, and I have some brochures here. I would encourage you to ask your colleague or colleagues to attend to this workshop. The idea here is we want to provide them hands-on experience of these case studies so that they can use the modules in their classes. Thank you very much.
Well, the last panelist here is Professor Dave Wallace of our department, and he made a presentation. Dave, would you like to add some more?
I'm on a short tether. Anyway, I'll make this very brief since I've already said a fair bit about the subject. What I thought I would do is just briefly describe the course that I, the undergraduate course that I teach. It's a core course of 120 students per year, and it's a fourth year course, which is the last in the design and manufacturing series. And it's a course really about the developing products and the engineering process involved in that. And what we do is we really motivate the entire learning experience by putting the students in the position to develop substantial products, which they really have the ownership of the idea. And they work in large teams to do this, and they also work with real budgets of $6,000 per team that they can use for supplies, and there's also support and other materials that we provide as part of the course. And so the goal is really to build a real working alpha prototype. And to start the course, what we do is we provide them with a technology theme. And really, that's about it. So for example, last year, we had our theme to be that we are interested in developing products that assist the active elderly population. And our technology theme is we develop electromechanical devices, pretty broad. And so the students really take it from there and go through the entire process to develop, design and develop these alpha prototypes. Examples of the products designed this last year include a what's called a garbage porter, a device that picks up garbage pails and is almost like a powered walker that allows elderly people to take their garbage out to the curb, which actually is a large issue. It's an issue for my mother, in fact, but is in fact a large number of people with that problem. Another product which you can imagine is like the standing Lazy Boy, but what's unique about it is it also can be driven around like a wheelchair. So it provides mobility inside the house well in the chair that helps them also get up and down from the standing position. Other products include a powered wagon, because gardening is one of the most popular activities for elderly people. But it's a powered wagon with a very nice force feedback handle, so that it just, it actually has no controls, but just feels like a very light wagon no matter what you're doing. It just walks along with you based on your pulling on the handle. So that's what we do, and to do that, we try to take an approach where the faculty work very directly with the students. So the teams that are developing each product, there's 15 students for each team. There are two faculty members involved that are really down working in the shop with them throughout the process, and we're really following the just-in-time paradigm for doing this. And from a teaching standpoint, this is a very fun and challenging thing for the instructors, because you don't know what problem you're going to be solving any given day, and you get used to the notion of saying, well, I don't know how to solve that, but I think we can figure it out. And that's a very real part of engineering and research, for that matter. Also, in addition to the faculty, we have alumni mentors that work with the teams, typically two to four mentors, some of them in the area, some of them at a distance, to provide additional expertise. And to support that, we're working on, of course, the development of the web-based modules, like I was talking about, both on the process of product development and also on different topics. And we're also trying to work on access to expertise through alumni and other interested patrons, really. And so there's a lot left to do, I think, on that, the latter part of the support resources. But I really do think that this is, in some ways, the way to teach product design in a unique way that can really only be offered through the facilities that a residential campus can provide.
Thank you, David. I guess it's time for you to raise issues, questions, comments, what have you. So the floor is open. Yes?
Dave, I'm curious, is your group or your work the only work going on at the Institute in regard to residential training and web-based training?
No, there's a lot of... The question was, are there other activities going on campus? And the answer to that is yes, there are quite a few. There's CAES, which is Center for Advanced Engineering Studies, that does a lot. There's the MIT Singapore. There's work going on with Cambridge. There's also the Microsoft iCampus initiative, which is funding a number of different proposals to work on different aspects of use of technology on campus. There's the DARPA funding, which is also related to that. So there's a lot of different activities.
Yeah, the DARPA funding, which is $10 million,
right? Yes.
Specifically for enhancing residence-based learning using information technology.
And I believe that's being focused on that first year.
Yes.
As we talked today, this new way of teaching is going to require a lot more enormous effort from the faculty side, the new way of teaching. When it comes to tenure and promotion, normally research publications are given higher priority for teaching in our universities. What is MIT doing about that in terms of do they give credit the younger professors when they get to that stage?
Well, you know, all of us would have somewhat different answer to it. So my personal answer would be that I think we are able to attract top-notch faculty members who can do extremely good job in both. It's not the case of doing well in one and doing poorly in the other. And it turns out that our faculty members in this department are excellent teachers, and also they have international reputation in their field. And so I'm not sure it's a matter of trade-off. It's really doing both jobs extremely well. Just to give you an example, I'm very pleased this year that two of our colleagues received what MIT called McVicar Faculty Fellowship. What MIT does is select few people each year, and they will have up to about 50 people, and they give them special allowance for being a good teacher. It turns out that this year MIT selected six out of six, that's MIT-wide, and we have 1,000 professors, and MIT selected six, and out of six, two of them are professors of mechanical engineering. So, and in fact, one of the professors clearly got the recognition because of his involvement in our undergraduate teaching. 14 of our professors are what we call designated professors. These are the professors who are implementing our new undergraduate curriculum. They are the ones writing books, and indeed they are devoting greater time to make it happen. Some of them are not tenured, and indeed we look at teaching record very, very carefully, and if someone is not a good teacher, probably he or she will not be allowed to stay at MIT as a tenured faculty member. So you know, often we have discussion on this teaching versus research, but I say, one ought to be able to do a good job in both. Yes, Jim?
Professor Sue, would you talk about the new undergraduate curriculum?
Right, this, as I said, we graduated the first class in 1999, and we actually discussed this need to revamp our undergraduate curriculum for many years. Well, finally, we decided to implemented, and we had a great deal of disagreement as to when is the right time to implement new curriculum. Some people want to see all the details worked out before we implement, and some of us felt that you cannot really develop all the details because it takes enormous amount of effort to do that. So we decided to do this, and essentially the idea is that we wanted to make sure that we look at learning from the student's point of view and provide right context. So we felt that by combining some of these subjects in a single sequence, we can provide the context. That's, as I said earlier, thermodynamics, heat transfer, fluid mechanics is in one sequence. And at the beginning, there's a great deal of controversy because lots of professors complained about the way the person in charge was teaching the subject, but now there is no controversy. In fact, because students like it. You can think of the way we teach in some of these subjects like a peeling onion. We teach many of these principles at the beginning, and then we solve a series of more and more difficult problems, and through that, students begin to understand the context. They begin to understand the theories in the context of how real problems are solved. And I think it's working out well. And I can give you some of the stories. some of the professors in our department didn't like the way that that particular subject, and I can use some other sequence and I can give you the same story, did not like the way it was presented. And it turned out that we just hired one of the senior professors from outside in the fluid mechanics area, and he taught the subject in two different ways, and then he came to the conclusion that new ways better, better ways of teaching it, and that they sort of stopped any additional discussion on the subject because one person who was not biased one way or the other came into teaching of the subject and then decided that the new way of teaching is better. Normally, when we teach it this way, students complain a lot during the first term. In this subject, it's a two-term sequence. First term, they complain a lot because they are given all these basic principles all at once, the ones in thermodynamics, heat transfer, and fluid mechanics. But at the end of the second term, students really feel good about it. If you look at student evaluation, that's how exactly how it comes out. And so that professor who did that was selected as the McVicker teaching the faculty fellow this year. And it's, you may think that I'm boasting, but in some ways I guess I am. But you know, one of our young faculty members was so great. He's an untenured faculty. And he, the, anyway, he was elected to be this chair full professor in the Department of Applied Mathematics and Physics at the Cambridge University. And I am trying hard not to lose him, but it's a very strong statement that indeed we have very strong young faculty to be chosen as one of the few senior faculty members at the University of Cambridge, and he's not even tenured here. So anyway, we have very strong faculty. Yes?
Yes. This morning we saw how information technology has been integrated into research projects to make new intelligent machines more innovative products. But this afternoon in the education session, we saw information technology used only as a tool to deliver the education to the students. Has information technology been integrated in the curriculum so that the graduating engineers will be able to develop intelligent products?
Well, Dave Wallace's presentation really dealt with that issue. And a number of professors are incorporating technology in many of their subjects. They use lots of simulations in their teaching. But I must confess, I guess we're still in the early phase of introducing information technology in our courses. Yes?
I do not mean as a tool, but I mean in the subject content, like the mechanical engineers learning information technology subjects to integrate them into their mechanical engineering training.
I can talk about that. Actually, we have over the past 5 years, a fairly large number of courses have been developing that. For instance, Sunny Sue is teaching a graduate course on the internet. You mentioned that he's part of the...
It's undergraduate subject.
And we're both graduate and undergraduate, right? It's an undergraduate, a freshman sophomore course based on for the internet. I believe you're also on a committee to look into the possibility of having a computer, a programming requirement. Is it? Is that right? Yeah, I've developed both graduate and undergraduate courses in mechanical engineering, specifically on the subject of information, and together with Paul Penfield, who just stepped down as head of electrical engineering and computer science, we're teaching a freshman course on what information is. So to introduce freshmen to the subject, it's got 70 people in it, it's doing pretty well. We have courses on mechatronics. We have graduate courses in which on information, adding information and control. Actually, information is really quite well integrated at the moment into our curricula. We don't have any required, it's not required in the part of the undergraduate core, but there are many options for undergraduates in mechanical engineering to learn about information technology.
Yeah, we are very serious about the incorporating information technology in all phases of our undergraduate and graduate education. So I think you'll see more of this happening in the years and the decades to come. Yes?
May I actually comment further on that? That one of the things that I've often heard the older professors in the department complain about...
You mean senior professors?
Senior professors. Pardon me. Some of the senior professors is that the incoming students have never used a wrench or a screwdriver. And actually, junior professors complain about this too.
and it's true, all right? People used to take apart cars and take apart mechanical devices. They don't any longer, because when you take them apart and put them back together, they don't work, right? So you can't do it. Now, this is seen as a big problem in teaching mechanical engineering. How do you teach mechanical engineering to mechanical illiterates? However, there is a flip side to this, which is that the students who are coming in right now are often much better off in terms of knowing about information technologies than both junior and senior professors in the department. Right? How often have you asked a graduate student to make your disk drive work, right? I certainly have done that a bunch of times. And these students actually, they come in some sense, they don't know about fixing machines, but they know about fixing bits, right? They're primed to know about bits. In our freshman course that we're teaching with Paul Penfield, it's amazing how much those students know about information and information technologies. It makes it really easy for us to teach the course, because it's as if, they were taking apart cars, except they're not. They're taking apart computers, installing disk drives, installing programs. They know about information technology. So, this is what we're teaching them reflects what they actually come to us already possessing.
In fact, just to augment what Seth said, that we are teaching now, we just created for the first time this term, freshman subject, where students are asked to take things apart and assemble it, understand how mechanical things really work. And also, at the same time, we try to teach them a little bit about history of technology. So this is a freshman elective subject, and we think that will do them a lot of good.
Most important information technology incursions into mechanical engineering is in the whole area of measurement. The society is becoming ubiquitous with measuring devices, and I think it's absolutely important that our students know the ramifications of that and how to deal with the information that those instruments deliver. I think it could be a really important distinguishing characteristic of the next generation of students that they feel as comfortable using A to D and D to A devices to control and manipulate and design things as they do using wheels and gears and pulleys, because that's where it's at, and that is, in fact, information technology. They need to know how to deal with that information in an economical way and know the pieces that go into it. I have a graduate course on advanced instrument design, which is basically focused on that issue.
Yeah, just to add to what Forbes do is that we have about 60 professors. And you can see that you saw roughly maybe 1/6 of our department here today. And people in other fields like manufacturing, bioinstrumentation, and so on and so forth, they are doing a great deal of the research as well as trying to create educational paradigms involving IT. So you haven't seen that aspect. In fact, many of our manufacturing colleagues are working on the things that require information technology as well. But you haven't seen that. Just too many people. Yes?
I have a question for Dave Wallace. You quoted the sobering number of 500 hours of preparation time for 1 hour of lecture material on the web. Do you have any suggestions for dealing with that seeming roadblock?
Sure. Well, I guess the way to think about those materials, the way I would think about it is people are used to spending a long time writing a book. And there is that very large figure of preparing the materials, and that's in a sense to be honest with you, that same lecture for me to do it live in class required about 50 hours of prep because of a lot of the props were actually used the same. But some of that time was production time. Some of that time was intellectual content development. The pure intellectual content development was on the order of the 50 to 70 hours. The rest of it was some form of production or other. And so, one of the clear messages is, there needs to be an infrastructure in place that makes it a tenable proposition so that, if you will, the different people in the chain of producing the material contribute in the area that is their, you know, most valued competency. And so that's one of the things that would change, because obviously that's not something, you know, every faculty member is going to do for every lecture. So there needs to be the appropriate chain, and then there needs to be the delivery mechanism so we can choose the subjects and do that for the ones where there is the audience to support it. And it actually, I think, can fairly quickly end up being a very economical way to do things.
Well, now the Dave can do this in about 5 days or so. He puts in about 120 hours a week. So 100 hours of effort is not that much. Any other comments? Yes?
It seems like there's I sense some beginning of a revolution in mechanical engineering education here, and it's a rude awakening that Seth mentioned over here, that there is a group of incoming mechanical engineering students that do not know the gears and these traditional mechanical elements. Are we trying to redefine what mechanical engineering means, or do you foresee some renaming of a mechanical engineering to incorporate these new interdisciplinary aspects of mechanical engineering? What's happening? If other departments in the nation follow MIT, would we be looking at renaming mechanical engineering to fit what is really happening here, or are we redefining mechanical engineering?
Yeah, that's, I think I'm not really sure how to answer that, but we are really broadening what it means to be a mechanical engineer so that our graduates can deal with the tasks they'll be facing in industry, even in academia. It's no longer good enough to have a mechanical engineering department solely made up of thermodynamicists and applied mechanicians. And still a large number of schools do that, and indeed that's one of the motivations for having this conference, is that if we continue to teach only mechanics and thermodynamics or what have you, then I don't think they can become a leader. They can only deal with a subset of overall engineering tasks, because nowadays you cannot deal with overall engineering tasks without knowing software, without knowing control, without knowing how to deal with information technology, how to manage people, and so on and so forth. And then at least by exposing our students to what's out there, by creating a big window through which they can look out, at least knowing that there are such sub-branches of engineering discipline, they can become a more of an engineer who can become leaders and who can shape the future of technology and industry. So that's the goal.
But the industry out there has a very traditional mindset on mechanical engineering. So when they hire some people from mechanical engineering, they have a certain mindset as to what they want from these engineers. Maybe industry should be involved in all this process as well. So mechanical engineers are really trained with other interdisciplinary IT-based education other than just...
I don't think you have to worry about their world of business.
I'd like to ask the other two professors from the other schools whether you buy this argument or don't buy this argument.
Well, thanks. I made a couple of notes relative to the hands-on.
Or the broadening of the discipline across the, there's no such, the gearbox is almost purely mechanical and somewhat
right.
Thermal. The things we try to do today are much wider and breadth.
Mm. I think we don't believe we want to lose some of the hands-on aspects of mechanical engineering. So we offer something we call a hands-on short course, where they actually take apart an engine and put it back together, and it has to run or they don't pass. And in fact, it's probably the most exciting we see the kids is when they fire. I think we get lawnmower engines from one of our sponsors, and when they fire up that engine and it actually comes up, that's one of the highlights of their sophomore year, it turns out. In terms of information technology in the curriculum, I think we offer measurements at the undergraduate level, and we factor in. I mean, I even taught assembly code to mechanical engineers for a while because I believe you have to know what a computer is and the architecture to succeed. Now, not everyone agrees with that approach. And then in terms of IT, we've offered, I think we're just starting to move down to the undergraduate. We have a course that's it's like our senior design and manufacturing. It has rapid prototyping, CAD-CAM type things. We offered that in conjunction, so that's undergrads elective. We offered it in conjunction with a smart machines course. So we had teams of grads and undergrads who had to build a device with an embedded microsystem. So it actually had to carry something out, so an electromechanical system. So I think we're having it both ways.
I agree with my colleague here, but some of the restrictions our schools have is, and probably MIT doesn't have, is we have to satisfy ABET criteria. MIT probably doesn't have to. So we are restricted to a certain extent to cater to the industry needs of our region. Say, for example, I'm coming from Auburn, Alabama. So we have to have our industry input into our curricula, which is the basis of ABET 2000 assessment. And so that's the reason why, for example, my presentation concentrated on developing modules to help our professors in getting the ABET 2000 criteria satisfied. But MIT probably has the luxury of not doing it, but that doesn't mean we are not taking the cue from MIT and the discussions we have here. For example, information technology is integrated into some of our courses in the form of mechatronics, instrumentation, and other things. So that's where the difference is.
Maybe unique in Berkeley, but if we look at the application of high school, there is a huge concentration in computer science, AI. So there is some simplified equation that information technology equals computer science, okay, among the high school kids. So I think your problem is not, redefining mechanical engineering, but related to the whole situation, unless this aspect may be publicized strongly to the high school kids. I think we are a real problem, because at least at our school, how much the enrollment may have, each department have, may be a basic model of currency in terms of faculty resource and the allocation and so on. So I wonder whether MIT is experiencing that kind of problem, or you are seeing that as an issue.
Well, you know, the obviously, you know, everyone watches student enrollment, where they go, and so on and so forth. And but basically, my sort of personal view is that we have to do what is right for our students. And if you don't do the kind of things we are talking about, you cannot even map the control engines nowadays, right? Engine management system controls engine as well as transmission. And without this kind of integrating tool, which is information technology, we cannot do all this. One of the things that was kind of interesting, amusing, and I was going to tell the our visiting committee on Monday, and Neil might find it interesting. Our mechanical engineering enrollment at MIT is still quite high. You know, we have 300 some students, sophomore, juniors, and seniors. And we are I think in terms of student enrollment, we are the second largest department. And at MIT, four departments teach about 70% of all our undergraduates, and we have 20-some departments, about four departments teach 70-some percent, almost 70%, somewhere around 70% of our undergraduates. And we are the second largest in terms of undergraduate enrollment. And during the last 5 years, our undergraduate enrollment went down from 365 to 315. And we've been sort of wondering why. And in preparation for the visiting committee, I was looking at some of these numbers very carefully. Guess what? You know, since I look like an Irishman, I can say this, eh? It's the Asian Americans not coming into ME. We had about 115 Asian Americans 5 years ago. Today we have 65. So that drop is all in Asian Americans, okay? And I blame Confucius' teaching because because Confucius' teaching always put these people who don't do any work and who use the, you know, their hands and want to compose poems as being the highest class, right? Anyone who had to use hands were at the low end of it, just of one notch above the merchants, eh? And I think that culture must permeate with this, all Asian Americans, because their parents must tell them something. But it's interesting statistics. Number of women students did not decrease. Number of the Caucasian students did not decrease. It's the Asian Americans that decreased in mechanical engineering. So that the problem that you are alluding to may have less to do with you know, the all student population leaning toward computer science or anything like that, but certain segments have certain cultural bias or whatever the case might be. So this is something that I'm trying to understand. Yes?
Yeah, I think that I have to say, well, I counted the number of students that graduated in computer science in Korea, and 85% of them are Asian in terms of the number of students in computer science department. So that is a draw to what that direction. But I have a question concerning the what happens. I think the expectation from a society, from Asia professor and also students. We seem to expect our students to be able to do hardware, also good in the software, be able to do management, good business skill, good social aspect and so on. But in terms of the program, we have a 4-year program. How I don't know what they explain at MIT, how can you fit all of that into the curriculum and let the student finish in 4 years?
You know, that the debate has been going on ever since engineering education got started about 150 years ago. But if you just look at just the raw data, it's the answer to that is relatively simple, and certainly my colleagues in electrical engineering and computer science would differ from me because they have went different ways. The knowledge our students had to be had to acquire, that's all engineering students had to acquire over these years, has increased all the time. In fact, people like to think that the knowledge required is increasing at an exponential rate. And I'm sure 50 years ago, 70 years ago, people said the same thing. And yet, we don't live that long. I mean, our life expectancy went up a little bit, longevity went up a little bit, but it hasn't gone up that much. And as a result, we have to codify what we know. We got to be able to somehow improve efficacy of educational process so that we can indeed convey more knowledge in the same period of time. At the same time, some of the things we used to teach to our students are no longer needed because we have better technology. And indeed, the things I still use, my logarithmic table at home, I happen to have it, and whenever the calculator, whatever, I use that to calculate it. But our young students, I don't think they would know how to use it, right? But they don't have to use it because at least I was told in class how to use that table, right? But our students don't have to do that. So I think there is a certain degree of efficiency, efficacy, and whatnot you can bring into teaching by using technology. That's, in that sense, IT is going to play a major role. Right? David?
I just wanted to add one thing to that, which is I think that with information technology and of course the increased access to information and the notion of modules for learning, I think also we can really expand in the area of lifelong learning, where you view the on-campus educational experiences where you need to get the core and the backbones, but that you aren't really going out there to what you, you know, everything for everybody to know, because you do a much better job.
Yeah, in that sense, just in time is very important. So people can just go into a module and learn what they need to know so they can do the job. Yes, there are, yes.
Yeah.
Would you identify yourself first? I should have asked here, so that you are the first one to identify yourself.
motivated change. So it was roughly related to much of what we're talking about. One of the speakers was a prominent speaker. Coincidentally, he was from MIT, and coincidentally, he was from the Mechanics Engineering Department. I wanted the panel to respond to this. One of the things he said was, stop lecturing, stop writing books. So you probably know who he is. I would want to know your response. Is that the future?
I guess I'll give it a try. I think it may get back to what Dave said about the learning styles. And I think some students respond to lectures and some don't. So I think at Purdue, we are trying a number of different teaching styles to address a number of different learning styles. So we have faculty that don't lecture.
You cannot create the kind of thing that Dave Wallace created on a video and whatnot without thinking through the entire process, okay? And so in order to be effective in teaching, you have to codify it. So that our students, when they leave MIT, when they squeeze what they learn, there will be something remaining in their hand in terms of knowledge. And so I think it's we will go through a transition. And probably, you know, the people said that books are needed starting about 100 years ago, practice is more important, and so forth. We went through this whole argument that design should be taught by letting students actually just get experience rather than teaching them any theories. And that discussion, by the way, went on in other fields as well, right? But what made the engineering education so effective, so efficient, is because of codification. So that instead of teaching how something should be done, we came up with a control theory. By teaching control theory, we have been able to now deal with control of nonlinear systems and so forth. And that would not have been possible without scholarly work. And writing a book, codifying it, is scholarly work, okay? And so we cannot diminish the importance of scholarly work in education. Otherwise, we'll just have a bunch of arm-waving people. So we just cannot do that. Yes?
I believe the same distinguished speaker last week mentioned that the engineering degree is going to be the new liberal arts degree for the century. And should we be conveying that message to the high school students like Gupta? Or what is the role of mechanical engineering? Since mechanical engineering is the broadest of all engineering degrees, would it become a new liberal arts degree? Any comments?
Anyone would like to comment on that?
I mean, I can say at least a belief that certainly related to product development, increasingly, in a sense, the mechanical engineers are the ones that get it to work. And so what that means is, which is, I think, very consistent with a lot of things we're talking about, there's a lot of, they have to be pretty well-rounded people. Now, if that's what you're implying, yes, I think the mechanical engineers, they need to have, of course, there's a core of the discipline, and you need, in some ways, I think, to be deep in something, but at the same time, we'll be increasingly versed to deal with a lot of these different situations.
Could you recommend that to the high school students and telling them that this is neutral, most
well-rounded? Yeah, I was told by the chair that we better wrap it up, so I'll follow his order. At the same time, you know, since I'm standing here, let me just say this. I think the most important part of engineering education is teaching students how to look at facts, how to look at basic laws of nature or basic ways of synthesizing things, and then think logically. And the power of logical thinking is what we're teaching in engineering, and that can be applied to a number of other areas. In many other areas, it's interesting, it's John Sununu said this at one of our distinguished alumni seminar, and it's quite true. In many other fields, they draw conclusions first, and they rationalize, justify by bringing all sorts of quotations, saying so-and-so this is it's same as what I said, but ignoring all other things that person said. But in engineering, we don't do that. And I think that power of rational thinking is important in all areas, and I personally like to think that some of our undergraduates will go into other fields and influence other fields as well. So if you interpret that as meaning that is the meaning of liberal education, so be it. Okay, and let's have a dinner, okay? Thank you.